So I'm going to switch to English. So welcome everyone. We have a Brenda Samaniego de la Parra. Brenda is a Mexican economist from ITAM, has a PhD in economics from Universidad de Chicago, Chicago University. So Brenda, you're welcome. Go ahead. You can start when you
Thank
want.
you. Thank you. Yeah, I'll go right into it. So thank you very much for the invitation and for being here today. I'm going to tell you about joint work with Andrea Otero Cortez and Leonardo Morales, both of whom are at Banco de la República in Colombia. So this paper is about the labor market effects of a policy in Colombia that seeks to introduce some flexibility into the labor market. So I'm looking forward to all of your comments. Please stop me and ask questions at any point via the chat, or just go ahead and unmute yourself if you want to. Also, Andrea, I think I saw my co-author is in the audience, so she'll be available to answer some of the harder questions at any point. Also, again, you can ask questions in English or Spanish, whichever one is fine. Okay, so a quick disclaimer before we get started, because both of my co-authors are at the Central Bank of Colombia, I need to say that the views expressed in this presentation and in the accompanying paper that is available on our website, it does not reflect the opinions of the Banco de la República or its board of directors, and all our mistakes are wrong. Okay, so let me start by telling you how we started thinking about this project, what motivated us to answer this question. So part-time employment is prevalent across the world. In Colombia in particular, about 6% of men and 11% of women who are employed in the private sector as wage earners work less than 35 hours a week. So they're classified as part-time employees. Moreover, these workers are overrepresented within the informality sector. So 3 out of 4 part-time workers are informally employed in Colombia. So they don't get access to a pension fund, they're not registered with the Social Security Administration, and hence upon retirement, they don't have any savings to smooth their consumption. So what we're gonna ask in this question is we're trying to understand what role does regulation, and in particular, how flexible or inflexible regulation is, plays on firms' labor demand for part-time formal workers. So it's easy to imagine why regulation might have a role in this question. You can imagine there's several policies that place certain thresholds on the number of hours or the number of days that a person needs to work before that regulation applies to them. And that creates a wedge in the cost of labor that can lead to structural shifts in the use of part-time workers. So what I mean by this is to give you an example in the US, the Affordable Care Act had a mandate that required employers to firms that had more than 50 employees to provide health insurance, but only for their full-time workers. And hence, if I wanted to hire someone, if I hire them as full-time, now I need to have this additional cost. And instead, if I hire 2 part-time workers, I could avoid that cost. So it's easy to see how these sorts of regulations that apply to a particular worker based only on their work schedule can create this wedge between the cost of hiring 1 worker versus 2 part-time workers. Similarly, in Colombia, before 2014, pension contributions were tied to the full-time minimum wage. So what I mean by this was that you had to pay at the very least a proportion of the monthly minimum wage into a pension fund. So this made it such, as I will show you with more detail and an example in a few slides, this made it such that it was much more expensive to hire a worker formally if they were working for less than 30 days in the month than it would be to hire a full-time worker. So again, this creates this wedge and potentially disincentivizes firms that have a need to hire part-time workers from formalizing those workers. And so that's the general motivation. So what we're going to analyze in this paper is a reform that Colombia's government introduced, known as Decreto 2616. So many of you in the audience today might be familiar with this reform, but let me just give you a brief description. So by law, you know, in theory, employers are supposed to register their workers in the pension system and make contributions to their retirement. So whenever you hire a worker, you need to let the Social Security Administration know that this worker is now your employee. You need to let them know what their employee's
okay.
wage is.
I found this on the web for employers.
Sorry. You need to let them know what the employee's wage is and then make a tax payment with each of their wage payments. However, before 2014, the cost of doing so was tied to formal employment. So the tax base, the contribution base, was the maximum between the worker's monthly wage and the monthly minimum wage. Moreover, whenever a worker was registered with the Social Security Administration in Colombia, they lost access to a subsidized healthcare system. So besides making contributions to their pension fund, both the employer and the employee had to also make contributions to their healthcare funding, right? So these two requirements made it such that, again, part-time work was relatively more expensive than full-time employment. Then comes Decree 2616 that lowered the effective tax rate for part-time workers. So again, show you in some slides what exactly that looked like, but that's the idea. This reform decreased the cost, or at least made it such that it wasn't more expensive to hire full-time workers than it was to hire part-time workers. So there's a lot of literature that is relevant for our paper. I just want to highlight a few papers that motivated us when thinking about this problem. One strand of the literature that is relevant is just the literature that explores how changes in regulation enforcement, in particular labor regulation enforcement, affect labor demand for workers, and in particular for formal workers. So the idea behind this literature is that across a country or across sectors, the government may have different levels of enforcement. So what this literature finds is that when enforcement is higher, there tends to be more incentive. So when the probability of getting caught hiring workers informally is higher, firms tend to hire more workers formally. There are these trade-offs that firms are making between paying a tax or paying a penalty for not following the rules. So we're related to the literature in the sense that in our paper, firms are gonna be making not just that trade-off between following the rules and paying taxes, between not following the rules and having some sort of penalty for that and or paying taxes, but they're also gonna have this additional trade-off between like, should the worker be hired part-time or full-time?
I have a little question.
Yeah, go ahead.
This regulation enforcement is difficult, is harder for the governments. Yes, do the enforcement in the intensive margin and that in extensive, maybe inside a firm with mix of formal and informal, inside a firm, a formal firm. And I think about, the paper of this guy in UCL.
You're thinking about Elisea, yes, Gabriel Elisea.
UCL, yes.
So, let me do some self-promotion here. So my paper with Leon Fernandez Bujanda that is cited here in the slides. So in that paper, precisely what we're analyzing is informality within firms. So we analyze how enforcement activities of the government affect a firm's decision to hire workers formally or informally when the firm is itself formal. So it's an important margin and an important question, right? Because the penalty and the probability of getting caught is different when the firm is completely informal, so they don't have any workers hired with Social Security, versus when you have a firm that is officially set up, it's in the radar by the government, and then they just decide which workers to pay off the books and which ones to keep on their books. So the question is different. I think in our setting, we're thinking about informality within the firm. So we're thinking that the firm has the possibility of hiring workers formally or informally. So they can do both. So that's the setting that we're thinking about. But you could imagine also extending this to a more general setting where firms themselves are fully informal and then they have this additional extensive margin. Mm-hmm. Okay. So the other set of standard literature that we're related to is the literature that looks at health insurance premiums and work schedule cutoffs. So like I was saying before, in the US, the Affordable Care Act has this characteristic where if you have more than a certain number of employees and they're working full time, you need to give them healthcare. So healthcare has been a very common example to use because it generates this potential wedges between the cost of a part-time worker and a full-time worker. So in our case, it's not just the health insurance premium that differs between full-time and part-time workers, it is also the pension contribution. So there's this additional wedge in our example, but this literature that we cite is relevant because the thought process is the same, right? You have a regulation that doesn't necessarily acknowledge the fact that firms have the possibility of avoiding the rules by hiring workers part-time instead of full-time, and maybe even pretending to hire workers part-time instead of full-time. So we're gonna look at that margin as well. Okay, so just to give you a quick preview of the results, what we're gonna answer is what were the effects of Colombia's 2016 decree that allowed part-time contributions to Social Security? And we're gonna answer this question along three margins. So the first one is we're gonna look at formal sector entry. So we're gonna look at how many individuals start working as part of the formal sector as a result of the reform. So people who weren't previously formal that now become formal. And what we find there is that the probability of new contributions to the pension system, so these are people who were not affiliated with the pension system before, the probability of starting a new affiliation increased by 5.4 percentage points. And importantly, this only increased for workers that were eligible. So the reform was targeting a particular segment of the labor force, low-income part-time workers who were not previously registered with the Social Security system. And among that segment specifically is where we see the increase in entry. Among other sectors that maybe satisfied one of the criteria, but not another one, we don't find an effect. So this is an important evidence that the reform in fact did help those workers that it was targeting and no one else. The next thing that we explore is just how did it affect formal employment. So what we find in that sense is that first of all, firms that start using the new contract type created by the reform experience higher formal employment growth than those firms that look very similar to them. So they're in the same location, same city, same industry. Those other firms that don't use the new contract type experience lower formal employment growth. Most of this growth was driven by formal job creation of part-time workers. So this perhaps is not too surprising, right? Now what I'm saying is that reform seems to have decreased the cost of formality for part-time workers. And what we find is that firms that use the new contracts are using them precisely to hire more formal part-time employment. So again, the reform seems to have done what it was meant to do. Now, importantly, this finding is comparing firms that self-select into using the contract against those that self-select into not using them. So even though we don't find any evidence of difference between these two types of firms before the reform, which makes us think that if there was self-selection, it was selection that is not correlated with the outcomes that we explore. But even so, we look at this further and we develop a model to help us try to understand the demand for part-time formal employment with and without the change caused by the reform. And what we find is that there is an inverted U-shaped relationship between the change in full-time formal employment growth and the pre-reform share of part-time workers. So I'll of course explain in more detail what we mean by this, but one of the takeaways from this theoretical exercise, which we then compare to our empirical results, is that whether a reform that lowers the cost of part-time formal employment leads to more formal employment or less depends on the characteristics of the production function at the firm level. So if a firm's production function is such that it can easily substitute between formal and part-time work, then we're going to see an increase in formal employment because the firm is going to hire more part-time workers. If instead this substitution is hard to do, then we could potentially see negative effects in total employment. Finally, we also analyze the effect on wages. We find a small but only temporarily negative effect on wages that reverses after a few quarters from the reform. So there's just a small temporary decrease in the average wage paid by the firm. So overall, key takeaway, the reform seemed to do what it intended to do, which was increase formality rates within a segment of the population, where again, if you remember from my very first slide, 3 out of every 4 part-time workers in Colombia were informally employed before the reform. So it's a very, very large number. And those are precisely the workers that the reform was targeting and among whom we find an increase in formalization rate. All right. So are there any questions at this point? I know I'm just getting started, but I want to give anyone an opportunity to interrupt. Not okay. Let me tell you what's coming then. Oh, yeah. No? Okay. Okay. Let me tell you what's coming then. So I already told you about our motivation and the recent question. I'm going to give you some more institutional detail about the reform and which aspects of the reform we focus on. And then I'm going to describe the data that we use and tell you a little bit about who uses the reform, who uses the new contracts, and whether they are complying with this requirement that only those workers who were not already formally employed can benefit from the lower cost of formality. So we'll explore whether that is in fact the case. I'm going to present the model after that, and then our empirical results, and finally I'll conclude. All right, so let's talk about Decree 2616. So Decree 2616 introduced this new contract type that we're going to refer to as Type 51. So Type 51 workers or Type 51 contracts refer to a contract that is associated with this reform and hence has lower costs of formalization. So why are the costs lower? So before the reform, as I've already said a few times, the tax base was the maximum between the monthly minimum wage and the worker's actual monthly wage. So at the very least, you were going to pay in taxes for a worker, regardless of how many days they work, you were going to pay 16.5% of the monthly minimum wage. So that was the cost beforehand. So that generated a schedule that was pretty steep per day. So if you were only going to hire a worker for a day, you can imagine hiring someone maybe, you know, in the restaurant industry, maybe you only need them on Saturdays because demand is very high on Saturdays. So you need an extra waiter on a Saturday. So they're going to work 4 days a month, right? So for those workers, you still had to pay the same tax to the pension system as a worker that was working every single day. So if you're amortizing this cost across the month, it is much higher for the worker that's only there 4 days than for the one that's there several days, right? And this graph here in the slide shows that schedule that is decreasing by number of days worked. So that's the first reason why before the reform, hiring formal workers that were only employed part-time was more expensive, right? And here we have like a numeric example. So imagine you were gonna hire a worker for a full time and you were gonna pay them a minimum wage. So these are minimum wage workers. So you could either hire a minimum wage worker or 2 part-time workers. So you can see here in the example that the monthly wage, the amount that you would pay for monthly wages for either 1 full-time worker or 2 part-time workers is the same because you could apply a proportionality principle to the minimum wage, but not to how much you pay for pensions. So the amount that you pay for pensions for 2 part-time workers is twice as much if you hire 2 part-time workers than if you hire 1 full-time worker. So again, the main takeaway here is that the pension contribution was a quasi-fixed cost of labor regulation. It did not decrease considering taking into account the fact that even though these are 2 workers, they're only working half time, right? And then the other reason that the other thing that the reform changed was the contribution to healthcare. So before the reform, you had to pay, again, the same contribution per worker to the healthcare system, regardless of whether you hire the worker full-time or part-time. So the contribution was twice as much for two part-time workers than it was for one full-time worker. After the reform, if this worker was a low-wage earner, like in this example, their earnings are equal to the minimum wage, then you no longer have to pay this healthcare contribution because the worker doesn't need to exit the subsidized healthcare system anymore. So those are the two main changes introduced by the reform. And because of them, in this simple numeric example, you can see that while for a full-time worker, the tax rate, the effective tax rate for an employer was 25% before the reform, it was 50% for hiring two equivalent part-time workers. And then after the reform, for each of the part-time workers, you pay half the tax rate. So in that sense, it made it so that the tax schedule for two part-time workers was the same as for one full-time worker. That's kind of the nutshell of the reform. Now, again, not every single worker was eligible to receive these lower costs of formalization. The worker had to be part-time. So if you had a full-time worker that was a minimum wage worker and you wanted to say like, well, I no longer want to pay for their health for their health contribution because of the reform, that was not an option. The worker had to be employed for less than 30 days per month. The second requirement was that your total monthly wages had to be below or at the monthly minimum wage. Okay, so this had to be low wage workers. And the third requirement, which we argue is one of the most important ones to understand the impact of the reform, is that they had to already be affiliated with the subsidized healthcare system. So in order to be affiliated with the subsidized healthcare system, you need to be part of the census of the poor. You need to be registered in the CISBEN, and your score in the CISBEN, which I am hoping that this audience is familiar with, and I don't have to go into too many details here, but your score that is based on, you know, your social demographic characteristics and the earnings of your household needs to be below a certain threshold. So satisfying this last requirement is something that it is not easy to manipulate by either the firm or the worker. So if I had a worker that was employed formally with a certain wage, maybe a low wage, and then I wanted to take advantage of the reform and pay lower pension contributions, I wouldn't be able to do that because if the worker already was registered formally, then they wouldn't be able to be in the subsidized healthcare system. So this last requirement really generates a constraint that doesn't allow the firm to quote unquote fake hire workers as part-time. Okay, and then the benefits for the worker, they would get a pension upon retirement, they get labor risk insurance, food and education subsidies, the severance protection. And of course, like I mentioned already, they remain within the subsidized healthcare system, so they do not lose access to their health insurance. Okay. All right. So, I mean, the data that we're going to use for this, we're going to use this combination of data that the Colombian government kindly gave us access through its research group at the Banco de la República, which includes the following. So the first main source of data is known as the PILA, which is the Integrated Record of Pension Contributions. So the PILA, the data that we're using is from 2008 to 2020, so it's the universe of employer employee matched administrative records of all pension contributions. So this, we can track all formal sector employer employee matches. We can see, you know, a detailed classification of the firm's industry, the employer's location, the worker's age and their gender, and the wage that they're making at every point in time throughout the relationship as a formal employee with that firm. So going back to Leonardo's question earlier about whether we're thinking about this from the intensive or the extensive margin of formality, to reiterate my answer, we're thinking about it as the intensive margin, because these are firms that are already formally employed who have at least one formally employed worker already, right? Okay. The other data source that we're going to use is the GIH, so the Gran Encuesta Integrada de Hogares. So the GIH, as its survey, as its name says, is a survey. So we're going to focus on the 2010 to 2019 period, and it's a monthly cross-section. So unfortunately, we cannot follow households across time. But nonetheless, it's a very detailed survey that on average collects information for approximately 20,000 households per month and includes, unlike the PILA, it does include formal and informal workers. So we can see whether a worker is registered in the pension system or not. We can also see how long they've been contributing to the pension system for. And then we have details about their employment, their education, their household members, their living standards. So it's a very detailed survey. All right, so using that survey data, the first thing that we look at is just the evolution of part-time work and formality rates. So in this histogram here, what we're seeing is the share of workers contributing to the pension system by the number of hours worked per week. Okay, so we think of anyone working less than 40 hours as part-time employees. The blue bars indicate the period before the reform, and the red bars indicate the period after the reform. So just graphically, it's very easy to see that formality rates within each of these work bins increase to some extent after the reform. So for example, if you focus on full-time workers, which is these two bars over here, you see an increase in formality rates, but nothing compared to what happens to the group working less than 30 hours. So we see an increase, an important increase in formalization rates, specifically among workers who worked less than 30 hours. Among other groups, there essentially is no change or maybe even a decline. It's already just, you know, as a descriptive graph, it already indicates that something happened after 2014 that led to an increase in formalization rates for these workers that tend to not be formal. So the next thing that we do is we try to explore this question in more detail. So did the probability, not just of being formal, but did the probability of new pension contributions, so people that were not contributing to the pension system before and now are, did that increase among the eligible population? So what we're gonna do is, because we cannot observe transitions, because like I said, this is not a panel survey, it's a cross-section. We're gonna try to do our best to identify new contributions using the data that we do have available. So in order to do so, we start by focusing on people that are potentially entering the labor force just now. So we look at the population that is under 25 years of age with full-time equivalent wages that are close to the monthly minimum. So this is actually a pretty large share of the population in Colombia. So monthly minimum wages are fairly binding. So that's for example. And then we're gonna split them into categories based on their fulfillment of the requirements to be eligible for Decree 2616. So what does this include? The first thing is they have to be part-time workers. So eligible part-time is gonna be an indicator variable equal to one if the worker is employed part-time and zero otherwise. Informal is an indicator variable equal to one if the worker has access to the subsidized healthcare system and zero otherwise. And post is just a dummy variable equal to one in the periods after 2014 and zero beforehand. So, and my dependent variable, the outcome of interest is, have you contributed to the pension system for less than a year? So if the answer is yes, then your dependent variable is equal to one and it's zero otherwise. So by running this regression, this is what we find. Importantly, this includes a battery of occupation, sector, location, and time fixed effects. And you might also notice that in here we're assuming, so in this variable here, we're assuming that the access to subsidized healthcare system is time invariant. And this assumption comes from what I was saying earlier, that it is very hard to just all of a sudden enter the CISBEN survey and get a score that is below what would be required in order to have access to the subsidized healthcare system. So we're assuming that this isn't changing through time. So this is what we find. So if you focus on the shaded rows here, things to notice is that before the reform, if you were a part-time worker and you had access to the subsidized healthcare system, the probability that you were contributing to the formal pension system is negative, right? That makes sense. If you have subsidized healthcare, you shouldn't have access to the pension system. Before the reform, that was the rule. So it makes sense that it's negative, statistically significant as well. Also, importantly, any of the other characteristics before the reform also make it less likely that you have access to a pension system. If you're part-time, the probability that you contribute to pensions is lower. If you're informal, also lower. But after the reform, that changes. Oliver, give me 1 second. Yes. After the reform, the coefficient is now positive. So the probability that you have access to the pension system as a new entrant increases by 5.4 percentage points. But that is only true if you satisfy both criteria. So if you're part-time, but you do not have access to the subsidized healthcare system, then the effect is still negative. If you have access to the healthcare subsidized healthcare system, but you're not a part-time worker, then again, the probability is negative. So it's only among the targeted group that it increases. Oliver, go ahead.
Thank you, Brenda. Just a quick question. So based on these results, do you have a sort of estimate regarding how many people became formal?
So not based on these results. We can see from, a much more direct way to estimate that is just looking at how many workers are registered in the pension system with the new contract type, right? That's a much more direct way to measure it. So in our next results, what we look at is by how much did formal employment grow? And the answer is 6.6 percentage points higher growth rate. But so what this is indicating is the probability that if you're an informal part-time worker in Colombia, the probability that you get a formal job increases by 5.4 percentage points. The number of workers that translates into, we could potentially estimate it from here. We know, first of all, that around 11% of women and 6% of men are part-time employees. We know that 3/4 of that percent is informally employed, was informally employed before the reform. So if you put these two things together, you know that the probability increased by 5.4 percentage points. So that would be one way to estimate it. But we have a much more direct measure of the increase by just looking at the administrative data and seeing how many new Type 51 contracts there are. Does that make sense?
Just using the number of informal workers, which nowadays is around 10 million people, and if there is a probability increases by 5%, I would say it increases the number of formal employees by 50,000 people, but I'm not quite sure if it's quite the right interpretation of the results.
Yeah, so importantly, this is not 5%, this is 5.4 percentage points. So this is within the probability. So imagine we know, so you said that there are 10 million, but I think that's not the right calculation either. So let's say that if you focus on only the workers that are minimum wage workers, and then find the percent of those workers who are informally employed and part-time. So take the universe of minimum wage earners in Colombia, find the share of those that are part-time and informal, and then that share decreased by 5.4 percentage points. Not percent, percentage points. Mm-hmm. Okay. So the other thing that we checked to see, like I mentioned before, is we're making this assumption that manipulating the CISBEN is hard to do. So firms wouldn't be able to easily take someone that was already formally employed and switch them into these cheaper types of contracts. So this is something that we can observe directly in the data using the PILA administrative records, right? So what we do is for each firm, we look at where the workers that they hired under the new contract type came from, right? So the first thing that we find is that about half of all workers that are hired from this new contract type are workers that had never been formal before, which is again what we would expect. And only 3.5% of all the workers that are hired with a new contract type are workers that have in the past been formally employed at that same firm. So while there is some possibility of registering workers who already had a formal job at that same firm, that probability is small. And it is potentially the case that it doesn't need to be that the worker was formally employed at that firm immediately before the new contract type, but rather they might have been unemployed for a while and then, you know, enter the CISBEN and then were hired. So there is some potential for manipulation, but it seems to be relatively small. We estimate 3.5%. Okay. So the next thing that we do is we compare firms that use the new contract type against firms that do not, using a specification like the one shown in the slide right now. So again, importantly, this what we're looking at is, let's find the firms. So this indicator variable here is firms that use the new contract type frequently and compare them against the firms that do not. Now, firms are self-selecting into this. It will be very easy to for someone to say, well, wait a minute. Of course, firms that use the contract type are going to be different from those firms that do not. They are choosing to do so. They want to grow more, and hence they use the new contract type. All fair comments to make. I just want to highlight, though, that we are controlling for firm fixed effect. So any unobservable characteristic that is time invariant for the firm is controlled for. We also control for very disaggregated sectors and time fixed effects and for location year fixed effects. So that means that any other estimation that you have for these results that lead the firm to self-select into using the new contract type, it has to be the case that it is not driven by sectoral differences, location differences, or time invariant on observable firm characteristics. So here's a graphical representation of our findings. Again, consistent with the idea that before the reform, these firms seem to be similar than their counterparts that do not use the contract. We don't find any pre-trends in these variables. But then after the reform, we find this important growth in total formal, in the number of total workers. So these formal workers, and this is the effect. So you can see this big jump. There's a bit of a lag in how long it takes for firms to actually start using the new contract type. Part of this is like the red vertical line is just the moment when the reform was announced. And it took a while for firms to figure out exactly how to use it. But about a year after the reform, we see this huge increase in employment, formal employment growth. And importantly, this is driven by part-time workers. So full-time, so the number of full-time workers, the growth rate in full-time workers declines as firms that are using these new contract types. So again, this is not too surprising if we think about part-time and full-time workers being substitutable. Before the reform, was not allowing firms to choose the optimal ratio of full-time and part-time employees. And once their costs are made to be equivalent, they hire more workers, more part-time workers, and fewer full-time workers. That mean number of workdays declines as a result of that. The fact that you now have more workers employed for fewer days per month, and the mean daily wage experiences a small drop that recovers quickly afterwards. The average difference, by the way, so if you wanted a number about how much did formal employment growth change, the average difference here is 6.6 percentage point. Okay. So now, a big question here is, right now, so far, I've shown you results that indicate the probability of new formal employment goes up. It goes up among the eligible population, so informal workers employed part-time. And the other thing that I've shown you is that firms that use the contract type grow faster, they have higher growth rates in terms of formal employment than firms that do not use the contract type. And even though we're controlling for all of those things that I mentioned, you might still be thinking, well, but there might be something that you're not controlling for that is driving both things. So it's driving firms to self-select into using the contract type, and it's generating the higher growth. So it's not the reform itself that's causing this, it is that other unobservable thing that you're not controlling for. So in order to assuage those concerns, what we do next is we write down a simple model of labor demand, where firms can choose whether to hire workers full-time or part-time. And for each of those type of workers, they get to choose what share of workers to formalize or keep as informal workers off the books. Now, I don't wanna go into a lot of the details of the model, but I'll describe the structure now. So the first thing is the firms choose, like I said, part-time and full-time workers. Part-time workers are just gonna work a fraction of the month that full-time workers do. And there's this optimal ratio. So firms differ in terms of their production function. And those differences are reflected into how much idle time a full-time worker has. So in other words, there's different degrees of substitutability between full-time and part-time workers across firms. You can imagine some firms in manufacturing that can use, you know, there's no variation in demand. Manufacturing firms just need to produce some amount of output. They can store whatever they, if they overproduce, they can store it. So in that sense, full-time workers could be employed throughout. Right, there's little idleness in manufacturing. Meanwhile, in the service sector, you know, you're working at a retail shop, sometimes there's customers, sometimes there isn't. So if you hire someone full time, there might be, you know, sitting idle for long periods of time, and then you might prefer to have part-time workers instead to be able to manage the variation in demand that you experience. So that's the idea behind this optimal ratio of part-time and full-time work that differs across firms. It relies on this idea that some firms have different production functions and different demand functions that lead to full-time workers to be idle. So what that leads to is that in order to compensate for any output that is lost by full-time workers being idle, firms have to hire more than optimal number of part-time workers to compensate for that. So all of this, this is unrelated to regulation. This is just production function technology that causes there to be this optimal ratio of part-time to full-time workers. Now, where regulation comes in, so this is just the expression of like total labor that a firm is gonna hire. So a firm, the total number of worker full-time equivalent days is the number of part-time workers times the fraction of days that they work plus the number of full-time workers, which again, is just equal to the number of part-time workers times the number of days that they work plus the optimal number of full-time workers, plus any deviations from those optimal number of full-time workers that need to be compensated for the loss of output via more part-time workers. So that's just how many workers you're gonna hire. Now, regulation comes in because it affects this optimal ratio of part-time to full-time. So firms can choose to hire workers formally or informally. That is true both for part-time workers and for full-time workers. If you hire them formally, you pay a tax, TAO, that is based on your wage. But then there's also a fixed cost. And that fixed cost is precisely what Decree 2616 changed. So before the reform, you had to pay per worker the same amount. After the reform, the amount that you pay is proportional to the number of days worked. So this parameter that we denote as R reflects whether the regulatory costs are per worker or per day worked. Okay. All of these costs can be avoided if you hire the worker informally. But then if you hire informally, there's this informality cost that we're gonna assume is a function of the share of part-time and full-time workers that you hire informally. So that's this function here. Later, we give that function a functional form, but for now, we just say that it is increasing and convex. Okay, so this is the expression for the regulatory cost. And then we also assume that there's, you know, non-regulatory costs, of course. You have to pay wages, regardless of whether you hire them formally or informally, you have to pay a wage. Those wages can differ, whether you're part-time formal, part-time informal, full-time formal, or full-time informal. So there's, you have to pay a wage per day for the worker. And then we also assume that there's another quasi-fixed non-regulatory cost. So we want to allow for regulation to play a lower role. We want to be conservative in our model. We don't want to attribute any cost that is quasi-fixed to the regulation. So we allow for this additional quasi-fixed cost. So maybe firms don't necessarily want to hire everyone part-time because there's some costs, like for example, training or supervision that you pay per worker. So what we're assuming is that the production technology is such that there's a distribution of jobs that the firm needs to fill. You need a cashier, you need someone that is helping the clients, you need someone that is, you know, setting up your store, you need someone that is cleaning. So there's all these sorts of jobs. And some of them have higher training costs than others. So the firm wants to allocate the costs that have very high training costs to the full-time workers because then you only have to train one of them. Instead, if you have two people running, you know, a very complex task, then you have to train them both. So you want the high cost jobs to go to the full-time workers, the low training cost jobs to go to the part-time workers. And then there's, and that's what this distribution of costs reflects. So that's the setup of the model. The firm is gonna minimize these costs by choosing an optimal share of part-time employment. Within that part-time employment, is gonna choose how many informal workers and then how many formal ones. So the main takeaway of the model is that the firm is gonna, you know, equate the marginal cost across these various dimensions, is gonna choose part-time workers to be in the low quasi-fiscal stack. And for any given demand of part-time work, it's gonna hire the worker to be informal up until the expected cost of getting caught is equal to the additional cost of paying taxes and the regulatory quasi-fixed cost. So graphically, this is what the model predicts. So over here in this x-axis, we have the regulatory cost, which is changing from 1 to 0.5. So remember, 1 is before the reform, 0.5 is when the regulatory cost is lowered to be equal between part-time and full-time workers. So what the model predicts, so what we do with this model is we calibrate it to match the share of part-time employment and informality rates in the Colombian economy for each industry before the reform. So using this model, we can get a measure of idleness in the different sectors in the Colombian economy. So that parameter L, we set to match the share of part-time employment in the economy, and then we move the regulatory cost parameter to see what the model would predict in terms of part-time employment, informality within the part-time and the full-time workers set. And this is what we find. So the part-time share of workers was 15 before the reform in the sector of hotels and restaurants. And the model predicts that it would increase all the way to 55% after the reform. The share of informal workers in part-time work was almost 90% before the reform. And again, this is calibrated to match the actual numbers in the Colombian economy. And then that decreases per the model down to 30% after the reform. So this is one example. We could do it for any industry, but they all look fairly similar. So this is the idea. So then what we do is, what this model is telling us is that there is a, that we can use the share of informal workers in a particular industry or in a particular city as a proxy for this idleness parameter. So what we're doing in the model is we're saying, let's take the share of informal workers, use that to predict idleness. And then idleness tells us how is the demand for workers gonna change as we change HR. So now we're gonna try to bring this model to the data and compare those results. So the model is predicting that that firms that have a higher idleness, so full-time workers waste more time, those firms are gonna have a higher share of part-time employment. So they need to hire more part-time workers in order to make up for the idleness of the full-time. So they have more part-time employment even before the reform. They have a lower share of informality. And whenever you decrease the cost of regulation, they're gonna have a smaller response. Because full-time workers already were very idle, there were few of them. So instead of, there's no substitution effect between part-time and full-time workers because you were already at a very high share of part-time work to begin with, and you already had a very low informality rate. So the response to the reform has an inverse relationship with idleness. So we're gonna test that in the data. So this is what we do then. So we're gonna use data from the Gran Encuesta de Hogares to calculate the share of part-time work before the reform in each firm's industry and location. And then we construct deciles for that distribution and run the regression that we show here. And just like the model predicts, the response to part-time work increases with the initial share, the response to formal employment increases with the initial share of part-time work, but then declines. So graphically, it's a better representation. So the green dots, the green diamonds, show the responses as predicted by the model, while the blue ones show the responses as predicted by the data. So there's this kind of like inverse relationship between the change in full-time employment, which is smaller for firms that have smaller shares of part-time work, and then increases. So, and then here's again a graphical presentation. So this is saying firms that are in the top percentile of part-time work, those are the ones that have highest idleness, and the response is smaller. To be clear, formal employment still grows at those firms, but it grows at a much smaller rate. It's hard to see from these graphs, but you can see that this is, you know, a 2 percentage point growth, whereas here we have a 5 percentage point growth. So the response is muted across the distribution of part-time employment before the reform. Okay, so that is, I think I have 2 minutes to conclude, so that's a great time. So overall, the takeaways as we see it is that, you know, consistent with our initial motivation, policies that have thresholds, whether in hours or days worked or in general, that depend on the work schedule of the worker to decide whether they apply to them or not, they affect the incentives of firms to hire workers with different work schedules. If you put a tax that only applies to full-time workers, then firms are gonna have incentives to hire fewer full-time workers and more part-time workers. So in the case of Colombia, when they implemented a policy that lower, or rather than lower, maybe just made the cost of part-time and full-time work homogeneous, then what we find, not surprisingly, is an increase in the demand for part-time work and a decline in the demand for full-time work. And that response relates to the extent to which firms were potentially off their optimal trajectory of part-time and full-time work. So I want to emphasize, rather than just listing the results again, I want to emphasize a few things about how should we interpret these results in terms of policy evaluation. I think it's easy to see this and say like, oh, well, now firms are hiring too many part-time workers and firing full-time employees, and that's a bad thing. It may be, we can have a discussion about whether it's a good or a bad thing that workers are part-time or full-time. But bottom line, if the reason why firms had too many full-time workers was because there was a wedge in the cost that led them to not only hire less part-time workers, or to hire them informally, then that's different from saying like, oh, well, now there's this, you know, lowering of employment standards because workers have part-time jobs instead of full-time jobs. So that's one thing that I want to highlight. And then the second thing that I want to highlight is that, again, consistent with the model, we find this result that says idleness. So if the worker was idle, then idleness and the response to the reform are intertwined as predicted by the model. And the fact is that if what the reform was doing is lowering costs, then we would expect to see a larger response by firms that have less idle full-time employment. And that's precisely what we see. So in order, we cannot make this blanket statement about whether changes in regulatory costs are gonna increase or decrease employment. It depends on the production function of the firm. And in the case of Colombia, it looks like the effect of firms with non-idle full-time work dominates because we find an increase in formal employment growth. If the other effects have dominated, then we might find a decline. So I don't know if that's maybe too in the weeds to be super clear, but I'm happy to take any questions about that or anything else in the presentation.
Thanks very much, Brenda, for your presentations. And so if somebody have some questions, go ahead. I'm very clear. I'm going to read carefully again. I skimmed the paper, the working paper, and it seems very, very good. So I have no more questions by myself, but I don't know if Oliver or somebody else has some questions.
Yeah, the paper is available on the Banco de la República working papers website. And Andrea, if you have the link and wanna share it on the chat, that would be great. And then it's also available on my website, although with fewer cute graphs and cover graphics. Both of them are available. So
well, thanks very much, Andrea. Andrea sent the link. I got the working paper too. So it's very interesting in order to develop. We have a very strong labor market regulation policy problem. So it would be very useful for our discussions here at Colombia. So Brenda, thanks very much. We are very happy of having you and Andrea Leonardo work here. So you're welcome here at the seminar. If you have some working papers next year, we will be very happy in order to have you here.
Yeah. So, thank you.
Yes, thanks very much, and thank you everyone for being here. I'll see you on the next Wednesday with another great work. So have a nice day. Bye bye. Bye bye, everyone.
Gracias a todos.